us worship the King. Come, let us bow at His feet. He has done great things. See what our Savior has done. See how His love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lives in high. Oh God, you have done great things. You've been faithful through every storm. You'll be faithful forevermore. You have done great things, and I know you will do it again. For your promise is yes and amen. You will do great things. God, you do great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquer the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifts it high. Oh God, you have done great things.
Above it all,
our Savior, your name lives in high. Oh God, you have done great things. You have done great things. Oh God, you do great things.
Amen. We serve a God who has done great things. Amen. All right, you guys, you know, as I was thinking about services this week and just the songs that we were singing, a passage from Ezekiel came to mind where he says, I will take out your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh, and I will place my spirit in you. And I think sometimes just because for those of us who have spent some time around the church, we forget the miracle that that is, that God has literally placed in us a new heart that is inclined toward Him. So we are going to sing Nobody Loves Me Like You with that in mind and just celebrate the fact that we're not who we once were, but He's making us new.
Morning, I
Search. That announcement just made me think of a couple of things, and I know that during the pastoral search, we've got great prayer partners that are coming out and praying during our meetings. But another meeting that's going on at school every Friday morning is called FCA, Fellowship of Christian Athletes. We get anywhere from 8 to 15 kids on Friday morning at 6:30. They get themselves up and come in. So if you're up on a Friday morning, just be praying for it. We've had the principal, Mr. Trapp, came in, and he talked this past week. And the week before that, there was a JV boys basketball coach. Maybe some of you know Brian Johnson. I wasn't there, but Eliana's face was like, oh. She didn't know her dad could get up that early. So if you're awake and you're looking for something to do on Friday mornings about 6:30, just lift up those kids that are coming in. And then if you have middle school and high school K kids, bring them. Okay? All right. So the pastoral search. Last week, I think you guys were informed that we had two interviews and we were all excited and everything was going well. And then this week we got two no's. And it's frustrating. It's very frustrating. Our plan would be to be done all with this thing already. But it's not our plan. And we have to believe in that, and we have to know that God has a plan for this church and that his plan and his timing is perfect. And I'm going to do something a little bit different than maybe has been done by other pastoral search. I'm a teacher, so I'm always asking for volunteers in class. And I think it would be awesome if somebody would want to come up and lead a prayer for the pastoral search committee, because we need it. I know I do. I know that I'm feeling somebody right now would want to come up and just lead a prayer for us. Thank you, Dirk.
I can do that. I'm coming up anyway. So, dear Heavenly Father, we come before you today to lift up this search team and to keep giving them that hope and assurance and let them know that you are in control, Lord. We think about Samuel going looking for a king. Took him 8 tries, and he was a prophet of God and a judge. He was way more than these people on the search committee, and it took him 8 tries, and he couldn't find them. And so lift up their spirits, Lord. Help them to do this. We know the right man's coming. We know that there's a time frame that you have, and we are just so excited. We are so ready for somebody to come and just do a new thing here and do a good work and reach this community that... It's frustrating to hear no's all the time. But God, that's your answer too. Your answer is no to us sometimes because something better is coming. We're asking for what we want, and we only see the right now. You see the future. You see all things. You know all things. You know what's best, and you always do what's best. And help us to keep our eyes on you and on that goal. Thank you, Jesus, for your grace and mercy that flows and is new each and every day. Amen. Amen. Thanks, man. Yeah. All right. I, too, want to talk about prayer. And I want to tie these last two announcements together. The first one is, apparently good news travels fast. Because I'm seeing about 4 masks in here. And we just announced it at 9 o'clock that we are going to, in the sanctuary, because we have social distancing, you don't need to wear a mask. Because the state government, you're exempt. You don't have to participate in the mask thing. And we're going, oh, really? Where was the fanfare on that? Where was all the saying, you got to do this, you have to follow? No, it was just kind of sent out, and we just kind of found it and said, hey, look, they said we don't have to do this anymore. So again, we're trying to comply with those in authority over us. So here we are. Still keep the social distancing. We're trying to, when you go out and you stand in the cafe and are close to people, have your mask. There are people that will still wear their mask because that's what they believe they need to do, and so we'll respect them and you know, keep our distance and do those kind of things, all right? Next, the school's out party. 6-3 is coming. Always in the past until last year, right? Last year was not a normal year. We have done 24 hours ablaze. So we get people to sign up to pray for 1 hour in the building on the site for 24 hours so that we can lay a spiritual foundation and a foundation of prayer for these big events, right? Remember the 4 big events. The first one is coming up, school's out party. Next is VBS, then the big buck bash, and whatever the youth decide, if it's another shoot, if it's a lock-in, whatever it is, then we do a 24-hour blaze for that once they figure it out. So please, what we're trying to do, 2 people every hour starting at 8 a.m. on Friday, May 28th. Now, that's not very far away because we weren't sure we were doing it. We were. And then once Sarah said, yes, we are, takes Dirk a little while to get a little traction, get things running. And so now here we are. So that means because it's a short term, we got to break out the dreaded clipboards. All right. They were banned for a long time. They're no longer banned. We have to use them. I'm pretty sure God said, clipboards are okay. So go ahead and use them. Yeah, they were stone. They had 10 commandments written by the finger of God. But nonetheless, clipboards are okay. So sign up for that. There's also going to be an electronic sign up. Once we get this turned in, the office is going to post it on the website. You can call in. You can email. You can do anything to sign up for a slot. But I'm glad to see slots are filling up quickly. That's awesome. So keep doing that. So if you've never done or participated 24 Hours of Blaze, we'll be in the conference room. There'll be some music playing. There'll be a hymnal. There's a Bible. There's some scripture verses that you can go through. There's a program laid out. It says, you know, worship for 10 minutes, pray for 5, do this, do that. We want you to walk through the building and pray as you walk through the building. Walk outside where the kids are going to be and pray for a spiritual covering over all of that. Because we want these kids to be safe. We want them to have fun. We want them to know Jesus. And that'll be a good experience for them to know Jesus. So that we're praying. So make sure if you write a time down, put it in your phone, on your calendar. Because there's many times that I get, man, I forgot. It's like, okay, I understand. And here's the other thing. I've been doing this for, 15 or so years. I always seem to get stuck with the 2 a.m. to 3 a.m. to 4 a.m. slot because nobody will take that slot, right? I can tell you that is a great time to come in here. The building is quiet, and you will meet God. He will be here. It is a great time to come. So don't think just because it's 2 a.m. and you think you're sleeping. Yeah, God wants to meet you here and pray for these kids. Thanks.
Couple other things that are coming up. Memorial Weekend, the normal practice, of course, last year when I was here for the first time on Memorial Weekend, I was not aware of the normal practice, but the normal practice is to have one service on Memorial Weekend. So that'll be 11 o'clock on Memorial Weekend, one service. The other thing is, if we can get the ducks in a row, on Father's Day, all of the community churches will be meeting on the main square in town. We got a few ducks that need to get lined up, so pay attention. We might end up saying, no, come to the church. But at this point, we have, as a village, we have spent big bucks to bring in a big-time speaker. And I'm not going to tell you who it is right now because I didn't tell him I was going to say who it is. But trust me, it is somebody who has a heart for God. And it's not me, okay? And it's not Dirk. So anyhow, it's going to be one of those things community-wide. If we can get all the ducks in a row, and that's being put together by people other than us, but just kind of keep your eyes open. And I'm going to do one other thing that's going to put pressure on somebody. Sorry. whenever a song is done, there's a part of me that always kind of wonders what there is in a person's life that comes through the lyrics, right? And if you know the person, it really adds to the depth of the lyrics. There are a few people I know that have written songs, and whenever we've done those songs, it really is like, yeah, that adds some real gravitas. By one of the more famous composers in Stockbridge, Michigan. I won't name any names, but she'll be singing. The words of this song are beautiful and powerful, but I want you to grasp the additional depth that comes from having a sense of the person who put it on paper. It was introduced to you over the last couple weeks, but as you sing it, I want you to let it touch you as a friend, as a family member, as someone whose heart is God's. So let's stand together and let's sing. Thank you.
see there's beauty in the wait. So I come to you just as I am, pretense aside, asking your light to shine into all the hidden places where shame steals my name. Turn away and tell me to see the beauty in the making. If you can use this broken vessel,
loved ones. I have been, over many years, really fascinated by the story of Moses. If you've been following with Steve's messages over the past few weeks, you know we're going to talk about Moses this week. Specifically, one thing I find really interesting about him, and it's true with other characters in Scripture, is that when God calls him, we see a man full of imperfection, riddled with self-doubt, a murderer, running from who he is in a lot of ways. But God says, come, just as you are. And Moses comes to the burning bush, under this morning. If we can learn a bit from Moses and maybe come with a posture of humility before the Lord, knowing that we don't have to be put together, but we come with an attitude that says, you are God and I'm not. And I'm going to surrender to your holiness. Are there things, loved ones, he's asking you to lay down or to take up today that you've been resistant to? Because you'd rather sit on the throne. We're going to declare his holiness together. Lay down what you need to lay down. Let him be God.
adore you.
You are the one to whom all praise belongs. Help us put our hearts and minds in the right place, which is in submission to and in love with you. And help us to realize that because of your presence here, this is holy ground. So let us keep every part of our being in line with you through this time. In your name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. I will tell you right now that the guy who gave me the sermon notes for this today tried to cram too much into this. So you're going to get a whole bunch of information coming your way today, all right? This is actually dealing with one of my favorite people in the Bible, a guy by the name of Moses. He wrote the first five books of the Bible, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. Those five books are called the Pentateuch, penta like five, Pentateuch meaning toque. No, that's right. It's just the five books of the law, the Torah. And there have been those who have said, well, Moses didn't really write all of those. And just realize that there was a guy that came along later, a guy by the name of Jesus. You may have heard of him. He referred to these things as the books of Moses. So if they get the endorsement from Jesus as being written by Moses, I'll go along with it. Okay, so these are the books of Moses, but actually he was not there for the first book, which is Genesis, which is what we've been dealing with the last few weeks, which gets us up to the book of Exodus, and you need to open your Bibles to the book of Exodus, which is the second book in the Bible. And I think of Moses as Mr. Epic, because his story is pretty incredible, and it covers a huge span of the story of the Old Testament. And as you think, you picture him as Moses with parting the Red Sea. Some of us are more scholarly, and our view or our understanding of Moses may be more along the lines of this, which is VeggieTales, depending on your generation, things like that. But realize that Moses was Mr. Epic, and included in that we have his life, and we'll break it down into this way. The first 40 years of his life, he was considered to be and treated as a prince of Egypt. When he was 40 years old, then he went to Midian, where he was a shepherd in Midian for 40 years. We're going to break this down a little bit more. Then he had 40 years when he came back, and he led the people through the Exodus, and they spent 40 years in the wilderness. And then the epilogue has to do with the Meribah and Mount Nebo, and that's where Moses had to die before he could go into the Promised Land. And we're going to get to all of that, but that's kind of the way it is put together. But let's look at the birth, the 40 years to begin with. 2 years ago and a couple months, I was in Egypt at the Museum of Egyptian History. And there they had something very interesting, because if you read the story of Moses in Exodus chapter 1, there was the Egyptians were not happy for the big plague and things like that. He was put up to number two in the kingdom. We talked about him last week. But after Joseph died and after all those people of that generation died, a new pharaoh came in who did not remember all the things that Joseph had done. And they began to persecute the Israelites. And in particular, what they did is they decided that the Israelites were getting too populous. So they started saying, you have to keep the girls, drown the boys. That seems a bit. Mother, when Moses was born, she looked at him, and just like mothers all around the world for all of history have said, oh, he's so beautiful. He may or may not have been that beautiful, but remember, Moses is the one writing down the book of Exodus. So it's no surprise he'd say he was the most beautiful boy in the history of the world. Rushes. That's King James term for cattails, basically. Okay? And by the way, when I was in Egypt at the museum, this is actually a basket from around the time of Moses. That's an old basket. So it's altogether possible that this is a basket just like the one that he would have been put into the Nile so that he floated by just in time for Pharaoh's daughter to go, "Oh, look at that most beautiful baby in the world." And she took him home to Daddy and said, "Daddy, can I keep him?" And he said, "Yes, if you take care of him." This is all kind of a paraphrase. Okay, this is just fast forwarding. And she said, "I don't have the right equipment." And Moses' big sister Miriam stepped out of the cover and said, "Hey, I happen to know a lady who's right in her prime for nursing that baby if you want." And Pharaoh's daughter said, "Oh, by all means, bring her." It's amazing how God provides the right things at the right time. And so after that nursing time, we realize that not only was there the birth and this process of the birth, there were also some other things that God put in place. Now let's look at something else. During this Prince of Egypt time, I want to give you a couple other things that would have to do with the view that Moses might have had around the time that he was growing up. Slaves built those. They didn't. When I was there, the guy that was taking us through the history, he said, those were in place when Moses was there. Those would have already been built. And they were built by hired crews, and they have excavated the kitchens and all the things that they had for these enormous crews that were there to build the pyramids. But that happened sometime before Moses. But another thing would have been the sphinxes. And you go, why did the nose fall off? Is it bad workmanship? Not allowed to have graven images. They were not allowed to have statues of any living thing. So they desecrated it by wherever there was an animal that was a statue, they would knock the face off. See the sphinxes, they're all flattened right down. But anyhow, these are the things Moses would have seen. And this is where he would have been raised up. But during this time, things were really bad for the Israelite. Not only that, then you have the A, which is the fact that he was adopted into Pharaoh's family. But not only that, there was advanced learning taking place because with his own mommy, he was able to learn the things of Israel. But by being in Pharaoh's household, he would have been raised with all the understanding of the Egyptian culture, which prepared him perfectly for coming back years later to address a Pharaoh and to know how to do things right. So we have God planning 80 years ahead of time for him to be ready to come back for the time of the Exodus. But things were bad in an additional way, and that has to do with his departure from Egypt. And as you read through the story, as Moses was going through the fields, he saw one of the Egyptians beating one of the Israelites. And so he stepped in, and he intervened, and as a result, he ended up killing the Egyptian to protect his own countrymen. The next day, Moses saw two Israelites fighting each other, and he stepped in to break them apart, and they said, "What are you going to do, kill us like you did the Egyptian?" And he went, "Ruh-roh. I thought I did that in secret, but people know about it," and he knew that that was a serious crime in Egypt, so he headed for Midian, which is a big deserty area out east, actually, of Israel. So he went a considerable distance to get away from Egypt. While he was in Midian, Midian is neighbors to Israel. So Zipporah and her dad Jethro may not have been Israelites, but they knew the practices of Israel because they'd lived right next to there for years. He had a chance to meet his wife Zipporah. I think he probably called her Zippy. That just seems like the right nickname for someone named Zipporah. But anyhow, Zipporah was a shepherd or was a high priest. We don't know what Jethro was a priest of necessarily, but we know that they were people who had a heart for God. And Zippy was the one that Moses married. And that was just part of it. As he was out in the fields shepherding, he came across what? Anybody happen to remember? There was a bush that was on fire that refused to be consumed. It just kept burning and burning and burning. And he thought that was kind of interesting, as would I. So he went over to investigate, and as he got close, God said, stop right there. Do what? Take off your shoes, because where you are standing is holy ground. Where God's presence is holy ground. By the way, in the New Testament, where is God's presence? In the heart of believers and in the heart of believers. Jesus said, where two or three are gathered, I'm right there in the middle of it. But also, in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, it says, we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, it says, don't you know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit? So wherever you go is holy ground, and you should treat it like a holy place. We don't have boxes of halos by the door so that when you get to church, pick up ash. H-E double toothpicks? No. Because when you leave here, if you're a believer, you are taking the presence of God with you. See, you do not have permission to go out and live like H-E double toothpicks and then come back, pick up your halo, and be good for an hour or so. No, we are the presence of God. And just like God says, this is holy ground, treat it as such. Your life is holy ground, treat it as such. Okay? So, Moses said, I don't really get all this. And God identified himself with the phrase that we actually sing about, the great I am. Moses said, who should, because God said, I'm going to send you back to Egypt to get my people out of there. He said, who should I say is sending me? He said, I am who I am. Which is kind of a crazy statement in English. Sounds like Popeye. But when he said, the great I am, what he was proclaiming is that he is the omniscient, omnipresent, omnipotent. Yeah, the omnipotent. He was the great I am, who is the great I am, the ever eternal, always in the present being. And when Jesus in John chapter 8, when they said, who are you? He said, I am. They picked up stones to stone him because he was claiming to be God. And when Moses was at the burning bush and God made it clear who he was, that was a whoa moment for Moses. Now, God did say, I want you to go and I want you to get my people out of Egypt. And Moses said, yeah, but I'm not a good public speaker. He said, fine, take your brother Aaron along. Now, we don't know when God spoke, whether it was Aaron speaking or Moses speaking at the various times. All I know is God gave in to Moses and let him take Aaron along, and his sister Miriam was a prophetess, and she. But when Moses said, when I go before Pharaoh, what kind of authority am I going to have? And that's where God said, I'll give you some clues. What do you have in your hand? And he said, a staff. He said, throw it on the ground. Threw it on the ground, and it became what? A snake. And then he said, pick it up. And I'll tell you right now, that's where faith would have to kick in for me. I have no trouble holding a stick. I have no trouble throwing a stick down. You tell me to pick up a snake, and I'm going to go, I'm not so sure about this. But he did pick it up, and it became what? A staff. Cool. And then he said, now put your hand inside your cloak. And he did. Pulled it out. And what was it? Had leprosy. Put it back inside. Brought it out clean. Ooh. Cool. All right. And then he said, now pick up some of the dirt. When you throw it down, see what happens. He threw it down and it turned to blood. So he said, Moses, when you go before Pharaoh, you've got a few tricks up your sleeve. Now, here's something that's very important for you to know. When he went before Pharaoh, and he did that with his staff, what did the demonic sorcerers of Pharaoh do? The same thing. I want you to get something here. Don't fall in love with signs and wonders, because some of them can be counterfeited. I've had buddies that have been that have become believers that have come out of satanic circles and satanic culture. Do you know what one of the signs of the satanic power in them is? Speaking in tongues. Just because someone speaks in tongues does not mean they're filled with the right spirit. Now, is it a sign of the Holy Spirit in you that you speak in tongues? Yes. But Satan counterfeits everything. He takes everything God does and tries to twist it. So just because somebody speaks in tongues, that doesn't mean they're filled with the Spirit. What do? You look at the rest of their life. Because the proof is in their living. Don't fall in love with just the signs. Because even when they threw their staffs down, those became snakes. Moses' snake went, lunch, and ate all of theirs. So God still does have greater power, but don't be quick to just fall for the signs. Okay? Now, the next part is this whole idea of, need to put these on. I can't see my notes. All right, he spent time as a shepherd in Midian. Now, he had the burning bush. He had the power on display. But then he went to Egypt because it was time, at what age? 80, to lead the people out of Israel. Now, let me give you a clue about where he was going to be leading them to. I think I have a couple pictures here ready for you. Okay, where Moses is taking them is called the wilderness. This is a third of the way up to Mount Sinai's peak. I actually climbed up Mount Sinai just over 2 years ago. It's pretty rugged territory. See those little trees that are in the background down there? That has to do with a story in 1 Kings chapter 19 and 20. Okay? That's a memorable spot of a cave there, but you can read about that in 1 Kings. This was a serious hike. When Moses is taking them out of beautiful, lush Egypt, it's kind of a scary spot. In fact, here's the view from Mount Sinai. Pretty spectacular view, those wilderness years. Because what happened is God gave them help during the wilderness years. First thing, God heard. He heard their cry. He heard their desire for being released from the slavery in Egypt. But sometimes God hears us, and even when he hears us, things are going to get darker before they get light. I know when I'm out hunting, do you know when the coldest time is hunting? Just before the sun decides to come up. Because I think what happens is the sun sucks all the warmth out of the whole world. And you sit there going, oh, it's so cold out here. Well, in the same way, when Moses went, because he got there and he gathered the elders together and said, hey, God sent me to get you out of slavery. And they're going, good. But then word got to Pharaoh that they were going to be having this little discussion about the slaves leaving. Around talking about leaving, maybe you need to gather your own straw. And things actually got worse for them, and things just went downhill for them, but God still heard them. And a part of the preparation for their time in the wilderness may have been for them to see that God could help, could cover things, even in the bad times. I don't know for sure. But then what God did is, in order for them to realize how powerful he was, he had the 10 plagues. Now, I don't know about you, reading about the 10 plagues is really cool. But always was kind of confusing. Until I was going through some ancient history stuff and discovered that the top 10 gods, because in Egypt they worshipped all sorts of different gods, the top 10 gods were the same as the top, or same as the 10 plagues. You go, wait a minute. They worship gnats? Yep. They worship the sun and the moon? Yep. They worshipped frogs? Yep. And what God did is he went bang, 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 right through those first nine. Then he went, what about this firstborn thing? Well, do you know who everybody in Egypt was required to worship? The firstborn son of Pharaoh. He was the deity in waiting because the Pharaoh was a god. So the Passover was their most powerful false god being destroyed. So God has this whipping of their 10 powers so that when they got into the desert and they needed help, God's going, look my way, don't look back. Go back to Egypt. Even though we were slaves, we at least got to eat. God heard, and he gave them the Exodus. Now, we're not going to talk about some of the most fun part of the Exodus right now. You know, when they got down to the Red Sea, if you look at the geography of it, and they went down, they got to the Red Sea, it really doesn't make much sense. Now, Scripture says that they didn't go the most direct route, from your side would be, didn't go the most direct route back to Israel, because there were some things in the way that God didn't want them to have to deal with, that whole Philistine area and all of that. So rather they went down. And when they got to the Red Sea, now there are some of you who've heard about that being actually the Reed Sea. And that they crossed through this shallow spot that was actually there because of drought, stuff like that. Okay, in order to believe that, you have to deny some scriptures. Because in scripture, it refers to how Pharaoh's army, where'd that come from? Pharaoh's army, all those guys in the chariots, drowned. I pity the army that drowns because their chariots got stuck in the cattails. It doesn't fit the description. And it talks about the wall of water on each side, and it talks about all the different things. If God can do the miracle of parting the sea, he can part it no matter what depth it is. Now, you may have seen, and I've seen all sorts of things. Ron Wyatt was the first, and there are some others that have put pictures out there of chariot wheels and things like that, and axles that they have discovered on the bottom of the Red Sea. There are all sorts of people that deny it and say, well, it can't possibly be that way. Here's the problem. The reason they deny those pictures of the Red Sea is because those guys aren't real archaeologists. They aren't real scholars. Okay. But here's part of what is still in waiting. Because the Red Sea is where it is, no one is allowed at this point in life to actually explore it. Because it's in the hands of people who do not let archaeologists go in and explore that area. So even though you think, why can't they just send some divers in? It's a political thing where they're not allowed to. So there in the Red Sea would be all sorts of proof potentially of whether there was a Red Sea crossing. And I think it's going to be kind of like not happen. Then God's going to say, okay, let's open it up for some divers. And let's get some nice high definition video of all those chariot wheels and axles and things. I've seen convincing proof, but because some of the experts say, well, we know that's not real research. Bottom line is, I don't need anything more than Scripture saying they crossed the Red Sea on dry land to believe it. but that curious side really would love to see all of that. So God heard. God gave them the Exodus from slavery. He gave them the law. Now, remember back on Mount Sinai, that picture that I gave you partway up Mount Sinai? The description of Mount Sinai is that on the top of that mountain, that is when God gave Moses the law, the Ten Commandments, but all of the book of Leviticus. And he was up there for quite a while. And during that time, the Midrash and the other Jewish commentary on the scriptures, Midrash and, no, I can't remember what it is right now. Anyhow, I remember in the first service, but they said that on that mountain with Moses, there were the rumblings of thunder, but the description of the rumblings, it says that it rumbled in all the voices of all mankind. Okay? It rumbled with the sound of the voices of all mankind. So God was speaking to Moses in all the voices of all mankind. Interesting. They celebrated the giving of the law. They celebrated the giving of Scripture with a celebration for the Jews called Pentecost. Keep that in mind. Pentecost, the giving of the law. Fast forward to the New Testament to Acts chapter 2. When they were in the upper room, when? On Pentecost, which was the celebration of the giving of the law. And as they're in the upper room, there was a sound of a mighty rushing wind and a thunder, so begin to do. They began to speak, and if you read what it says in Acts chapter 2, it says, they spoke in the tongues of all men. Just like when God gave the law, when God gave the Holy Spirit, which is the law written on human hearts, it was confirmed with the same miracle of God speaking in every language. Isn't that cool? It's almost like God knew what he was doing all the way along. Now, let's look at God's top 10 for a moment. You know what we know that 10 as, right? The Ten Commandments. Do you realize that these are not a burden? These are a great list of freedoms. Have any of you ever been slaves before? You might feel like it sometimes. My son Jeremy, when he was little, we had taught him a song. My name's Jeremy Malson. My name's Jeremy Malson. I live at 222 Addison in Fowlerville, Michigan. My name's Jeremy Malson. We had taught him that little song so in case he ever got lost or abducted or whatever, he could remember that. Well, what he sang was, my name's Jeremy Malson, should be Cinderella. My mom makes me do all kinds of work. And he thought he was a slave. He wasn't. Oh, you and your life. Imagine a list of laws that says, if you steal, you're going to get treated the same as if you steal. And same as you. And the same as you. And the same as you. Because we are all God's people, and he is our God. And there's no distinction between rich and poor. There is no slave or free. We all live by the same laws. And all of God's people went, yes, this is awesome. Where we look at the Ten Commandments and go, oh yeah, thou shalt not, thou shalt not, thou shalt not. Of course, all of us would love to do all those things. We all want to lie, covet, steal, and kill. I hope not. All right, so God gave them the law. Not only that, God gave them the promised land, the land flowing with milk and honey. And when they got to the boundary of that land flowing with milk and honey, they sent in the spies. This is in Numbers chapter 13. They sent in the spies. No, we're like grasshoppers in their sight. Two of them, Caleb and Joshua, said, we can win it. We can do it. Okay, let me give you a comparison. When I was on that trip to Israel a couple years ago, we drove a bus from Jordan into Israel, crossing the Jordan River. This is a view that we had in Israel. This is within about a mile of the Jordan River, maybe 2 miles. Let's look on the other side of the Jordan River, within about 2 miles of the Jordan River, on the not promised land. These are real pictures from just a couple years ago. Go back to the other one for a second, Kate, please. Well, it's mice are hard to find in there. These are literally closer than Stockbridge to Malson. This is a picture from the mouse is hiding on you. Okay, well, you saw how green it was. It's a land flowing with milk and honey. But they're standing in this area going, oh my. There you go. That's what is promised. That's where the 10 spies went. Place. And when they heard the report, they decided to stay in this. And what God said was, for 40 years, you're going to wander around until this whole generation's dead. And that's why it's called the wandering for 40 years. Now, during that time, as they were wandering, there are a few things I want you to make note of. First of all, the Passover. What was there about the Passover that was so particular? That was the 10th plague. That was when God gave grace because of the blood on the doorposts. We celebrate that today in what? Communion. When the blood of Christ washes away our sin, washes away our guilt. But they had the reminder of Passover. And every year through those 40 years when they were wandering in the wilderness, they would celebrate Passover and be reminded that God had made a promise that they had decided not to take. The next P has to do with pillars of fire and cloud. Now, this is a very important one. When Moses was communicating with them, it was because, and this is around Exodus chapter 15, something like that. This is where God said, I will always put before you a pillar of fire at night and a pillar of cloud during the day, and that is how you will follow me. That's how you will know I am here. But it was Moses who spoke to them. But as Moses was speaking, behind him, fire or cloud? Or of cloud? Was Moses perfect? Okay, let me lay some ground here. The pastoral search committee is looking for someone to be your pastor. Brian Johnson may have been near perfect. I'm somewhat less perfect. Whoever comes may be more perfect or less perfect than either of us. But here's what you need to get. When someone has been called and placed in a position as pastor, as the one to speak for God, to speak God's word, like Moses, there's a pillar of cloud back here. There's a pillar of fire back here. Because of the call of God to speak, the call of God to preach, feel free to disagree. But make sure you're disagreeing with a person, not with Scripture. But also, pastoral search committee, make sure you're finding somebody who's going to teach Scripture. Because what is behind me as I speak, if I am teaching Scripture, is that pillar of God, that pillar of cloud, that pillar of fire that is God. God also took care of some practical things. They needed food, he gave them manna. They got tired of manna, he gave them quail. Okay? I don't know what manna was. I do know what quail is. If it tastes as good as dove, it's awesome. Dove was the best tasting small game. I was brokenhearted with it. Anyhow, Q, the other Q. Moses spent a long time on the mountain getting all those laws from God. Miriam and Aaron, his sister and brother, heard the mumblings and grumblings of the people as they said, "He's dead. We made a calf out of gold and put it up before them." Now, when I was on Mount Sinai, they said, "See that area way down there?" And I would have taken a picture, except that by the time we got to the top of Mount Sinai, it was almost dark. So the picture didn't come through on it. I almost died on the way down Mount Sinai, by the way. Cat tried to kill me. Anyhow, that's true. But as Moses was up there in the cloud, they were down thousands of feet worshiping a golden calf. Now, there are people who've wondered about some things that I've had the privilege of having a friend who taught at a mosque in Harrisburg. He's a devout Muslim. He teaches every week there. He said that Genesis and up to the golden calf, scripture is absolutely right, and that the Muslims believe that the Jews were the chosen people of God. But when they worshiped the golden calf, they turned their back on God, and God disowned them. And the blessing went to Ishmaelites instead of the Israelites. So just in case you've ever wondered, okay? So anyhow, the thing about being in the wilderness, mind your P's and Q's. Remember God's promises. Remember all the power of God. Remember that he provides with the quail. Remember, don't quit him. And this is the type of area that they were in when that took place. So during Moses' wilderness years, we have a couple things here. Moses had his zero moment. By the end of a holiday, you're usually pretty tired of your family being there and ready to throw them out, right? "Have any water?" Moses said to God, "God, can you take care of the water thing, please?" And the first time was in Exodus chapter 17, where God said, "Okay, Moses, take the staff that you have with which we parted the Red Sea." He said, "Strike the rock, and water will come forth." And he struck the rock, and water came out. Every time people needed things, God provided it. But then you get over to Numbers chapter 20, I believe it is. And they needed water again, and Moses said, "God, these hard-headed, stiff-necked people are thirsty again." And God said, "Speak to the rock." And Moses said, "All right, you guys want water? I'll give you water." And he took the staff and he struck the rock. And water came forth. But as you read that, what you discover is Moses put the focus on himself instead of on God as being the water provider. And God said, "Because you did that, because you took the focus, you don't get to go into the promised land." Temper tantrums can be costly, by the way. His brother Aaron died shortly after that, and Miriam also died right around that same time. And then Moses died just before they entered the promised land. In fact, here's the picture from where Moses was. This is Mount Nebo. And if you could really zoom in and look closely, you'd see over on this end, you could see the end of the Dead Sea, see the Jordan River out there, and they're looking across into the promised land, and Moses could just look and see it. Now, on the day that I was up there, it was really cool. There was a 50-mile-an-hour wind. You could just stand about like this and it would hold you up. It was crazy. But then to realize the heartbreak of Moses being there and looking. And how did Moses get to the point where he hit the rock instead of speaking to it? It says in Exodus chapter 34, verse 35, that Moses would cover his face with a veil. And in there, it makes it seem like he was covering his face because he'd go into the presence of God and he'd come out and he would be glowing so much that people would go, "Oh, you're just so bright, Moses." But when you get to 2 Corinthians, you hear a little more description of it because it says that the reason Moses covered his face is so that people wouldn't see that the glow of his presence with God was dimming. In other words, when he was right there with God, he was radiant and powerful, but as he became more Moses, his bulb was dimmer. I don't think there's a possibility that any of us, because people remember a time that we were just on fire for God and we've been cruising. And we know we're cruising. And God knows we're cruising. But we talk a good story so that nobody else knows. A part of what made Moses have his temper tantrum was that he didn't keep the fire for God bright. My experience is 3 days after you stop reading Scripture daily, you're going to feel like God's not talking to you anymore. Don't let it go. So the end came as he began to dim. But he did honor God with new leadership and a new law. He passed the reins over to Joshua. And not only that, he gave them the law again. The first giving of the law was Leviticus. The second giving of the law is Deuteronomy. Sounds kind of like duet, even though it's not spelled the same. Why did he have to give the law to them again? Because the first group had died off in the 40 years. Now their kids were adults. They needed to hear the law. And so they heard it all again. And then the D, he was disappointed and he died on Mount Nebo. So, let's look at the verse that goes with us. Instead of being bitter about the fact that God didn't let him go into the promised land, as he gave them the second law, or the law the second time, he said, "Let my teaching fall like rain, let my words descend like dew, like showers on new grass, like abundant rain on tender plants." Rather than envy, he gave them a blessing. When your lack of glow is revealed, don't get angry about it. Don't be bitter about it. Get things right and be a blessing again. So what do we learn from Moses? First thing. First lesson from Moses is God hears and answers. That was revealed over and over and over. But let's get into, we as Americans tend to think majority should rule. But do you know that in spiritual things, the majority is usually wrong? Let me give you just a couple examples. In Numbers chapter 12, Aaron and Miriam led a revolt against Moses. Didn't go well. Numbers 13, the majority of spies said, "We can't take the promised land." The whole nation died. Numbers 14, the majority said, "We want to go back to Egypt." Bad choice. A bunch of people died. Number 16, "We are equal to you, Moses." So God then killed a bunch of people. In fact, it gets so straightforward that in Exodus 23, look at the warning that God gives. Exodus 23, verse 2. There we go. "Do not follow the crowd in doing wrong. When you give testimony in a lawsuit, do not pervert justice by siding with the crowd." Do you know that we live in a time in our culture when there is incredible peer pressure to go with culture? Now, if you stand against culture, you better stand with Scripture, not opinion. But we need to be bold enough to be the people of God, knowing there are going to be consequences sometimes. But the crowd is so often wrong. The last lesson. I'll tell you right now, it's supposed to be 2 Moses and his veil. After Moses had been in God's presence, he radiated God's presence. But it says in 2 Corinthians 3:18 that we now have the ability to grow with ever-increasing brightness. Why is that? It's because we have something Moses did not have. We have the Holy Spirit within us. And because of God's power and presence within us, we can radiate God's power and presence. And that's where it says the very next chapter is of clay. But the light within is God radiating through me. Moses had to deal with just being in the presence of God, and as a result, he had his moment in the wilderness that cost him the promised land. I pray that you will daily, continually radiate the presence and power and love of God. Lord Jesus, there is so much from Moses. There is so much from his life. It is mind-boggling to see how much there is that he lived and did. But even more so is all that you did for Israel, for Moses, revealing the power of what you do for us. Help us to put our faith and our trust in you in every way, Lord Jesus. The one who will be your God. Help us to rest in you, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen. All right. Like I said, whoever gave me those notes put too much in. I apologize for that. I'll try not to be so long next time around, but God bless.